Okay, so today we are going to look at amoebic dysentery, also known as amoebiasis. So it is part of the infectious and vector-borne diseases series that we're having, but this is also under feco-oral diseases. So just subscribe to the channel to get more of these videos. So to delve in, we are going to get an introduction of what amoebiasis is as a disease. And we know it's a protozoal disease, which is also called amoebic dysentery or famously amoebiasis. So the infection is caused by a protozoa, which is a parasite, which is called Entamoeba histolytica. That is the causative organism of this disease. So to understand well the disease itself is that dysentery itself is not what many people think. It's not diarrhea. Okay, it means simply that the enteric system, or more importantly the intestinal tract, has some sort of injury, or it has been affected to the point that it is a bit abnormal. Okay, and that is where the name dysentery comes from. So amoebic dysentery life cycle is mostly made up of the two stages of the protozoa itself. And the protozoa itself normally has two main stages, and it has two forms, the cyst form and the trophozoite form. So these forms are the ones that propagate the entire life cycle, one form being very stable and it's able to withstand the harsh environment of an external environment. And then the other form, which is the trophozoite form, is the form that actually causes the destruction of the enteric system or the intestinal system, and then we have the disease itself. Okay, so we're going to look at the life cycle through those features. And as you can see here, this is a life cycle, which is basically showing us the different stages. Okay, so first of all, this disease is feco-oral, and we must understand that. So therefore, we get the protozoa itself, the Entamoeba histolytica, from either contaminated food or contaminated hands or water that has fecal content that has this protozoa. So once the protozoa enters or is actually introduced through the mouth of the host, of the new person who actually is getting this water or the contaminated food, it actually goes through the intestinal system, the gastrointestinal system, through the mouth, to the stomach, and that is where it continues its cycle up to the intestines, causing the damage that it does, and then comes through the anal canal, and then it deposits again its cyst form, and then the whole cycle continues all over again. So to be more specific, the cyst form and the trophozoites are the ones which are passed in the feces. Okay, so the cysts are typically found in the foam stool, whereas the trophozoites are mostly found in diarrheal stool. Okay, so infection by Entamoeba histolytica occurs by ingestion of a mature cyst. So this cyst is the one that actually is ingested by the new host. So, and the cyst is normally found in fecally contaminated food or water or even hands. Okay, so once the cyst is taken into the mouth, it goes through the esophagus down to the stomach, and in the stomach what happens is that because of the hydrochloric acid that is there, it causes the cyst to open up, and that process is called excystation. Then when excystation happens, basically it changes the morphology of the protozoa, and what happens, it becomes a trophozoite. A trophozoite is a more it's a form of the protozoa which is able to move very fast and penetrate through the intestinal walls. So as these trophozoites are released, they migrate to the large intestines and they continue multiplying, and they multiply by binary fission, and they produce more trophozoites. So at this stage, the trophozoites, when they start penetrating the walls of the intestines, they cause damage. Then there you can have some sort of bleeding, okay, inflammation at that site. And that's where you have other symptoms like abdominal pain and what have you. So this is what we're talking about. You can see this process here. Is that we have mature cyst which is being ingested. Okay, if I magnify this and bring it here, the ingested cyst goes up to the stomach and then it changes into, in the stomach, it changes into a trophozoite in the intestines because of the excystation. But as it is continuing to multiply and grow, again, it changes now in the later stages, like now in formed stool, that is later in the different parts of the colon. Now the trophozoites now start also going back to the cyst form, and that is called encystation. Okay, and then now the cyst that is formed is actually now excreted via stool. So formed stool which went through the normal process without any hurry, what will be formed will be cyst. But now, because sometimes you might have diarrhea and you have hypermotility of the intestines, you might have some of the trophozoites also coming out. So in diarrhea itself, you might have trophozoites together with cysts, but in a normal stool formation, you'll just have cysts, okay? So just to repeat the entire thing is that you actually normally take the formed cyst through the mouth, goes through the esophagus to the stomach, and now starts going to the intestines, small intestines. Because of the acidity of that area, you have the cysts opening up and changing morphology to trophozoite. That is called excystation. Okay, now as it proceeds down, the trophozoites multiply and they penetrate the intestinal wall, causing all the problem that we have, what we call the dysentery. But as it continues through the different parts of the large intestines and stool starts forming, now the trophozoites change morphology and they become cysts again. That is what we call encystation. And then the cysts that are formed, they are released via stool. And as they are released, then the cyst has the capability actually to withstand the harsh environmental situation. So if it ends up in a water body or food, then another person might take it up, and then the cycle continues all over again. So this image here is showing us the destruction of the intestinal wall by the pathogenic trophozoite. So that is basically how the cycle goes. So this is what we've talked about, the transmission. So infection is normally via fecal-oral route and also contaminated food and drink via exposure to human feces, okay? Or by basically infected individual. So large cases on outbreak will occur if we have raw sewerage contaminating our water body. So if we're having a water supply that people are consuming and then it is contaminated by raw sewage that still has this live protozoa, then we can have a large outbreak, which is an epidemic. Then sexual transmission also occurs, and these are the different ways. So as you can see this image, you have flies which can carry them, fingers, food, okay, so all this water which is contaminated, all these can actually cause a transmission. Now, the population at risk mostly is, most of us usually get this transmission or infection, but because of a good immunity system, then we're able to fight it off. But high-risk groups include immunocompromised individuals, individuals in mental institutions, prisons, those are people who are clamped up together and the sanitation conditions are not very good, children in daycare centers, and we do know that children have very little capability of keeping themselves clean, so, and they like putting their hands to, or their fingers into their mouth, so it can easily propagate the transmission. Severe infections normally occur when very young children in very young children and also in pregnant women, malnourished individuals, individuals taking corticosteroids. So all these individuals are people who have some sort of suppressed immunity because of maybe malnutrition, use of corticosteroids, and then also, you know, pregnant women and also very young children have low immunity. So how does the disease itself occur? Is that I think I've mentioned it earlier, is that the Entamoeba histolytica itself destroys the tissues, okay? So it has the capacity to destroy almost all tissues of the human body. And by the way, if you remember your microbiology, Entamoeba histolytica is also an erratic parasite. That means it normally would be found within the gastrointestinal system, but the problem is it has tendency to go to other tissues. So it might be found in the liver, can be found in other parts of the body, because it moves to different organs where it is normally not found. But however, the intestinal mucosa, the liver, the brain, the skin, all these places can be affected. So to produce the damage, the trophozoite must first of all colonize the colon. So they have to reproduce and become so many, then they start injuring the colon through a penetration. So they penetrate the mucus layer, and they adhere to the host cell, okay? So once they break the barrier, then they reach the enterocytes, and which initially produce a superficial epithelial erosion. So the breakage from the mucus layer causes a some sort of erosion, and then you'll have ulceration, which may deepen and progress as more and more trophozoites are formed and they colonize the area. So further progression of the lesions may produce loss of the mucosa and the submucosa and cause a perforation. Okay, so this perforation of the colon now is the part that is now very painful. So the amoeba itself can spread from the intestines to the liver, causing what we call extraluminal to the portal circulation. Now that is normally once now it penetrates or perforates the colon. So what you're talking about is that you'll have ingestion of the cyst, excitation, production of trophozoites. Now more production of trophozoites colonize the large intestines. They destroy the tissues and they invade there. They cause ulcer in the colon itself, and then they can either exit through the stool, or which is not the normal process of a normal luminal amoebiasis, but however, the ulcers can penetrate and migrate to the bloodstream, which is now the portal circulation, which ends up in the liver, and then now the protozoan now colonizes the liver again. Then you have liver amoebiasis. Okay, so that can also happen. So clinical features, as I said, most of us have actually had it, but because of its mild form, we've not been able to actually demonstrate the signs and symptoms. So it can be symptomatic, where the most you can have is a mild abdominal discomfort, but no other signs. Okay, so this is where majority of the people actually have. Then we go to intestinal amoebiasis clinical features, where the common thing is abdominal discomfort. Then we have loose motions or diarrhea, frank diarrhea, which means there's some sort of blood there, but we might have blood or excess mucus. Okay, so in most severe cases, stool rapidly becomes blood stained with mucus. Then you have tenesmus, which is basically the feeling that you have to pass a lot of stool, even if there's nothing that is coming out. More features, you'll have watery, foul-smelling diarrhea, which has blood streaked mucus. Then abdominal tenderness on physical examination. Then the liver may be slightly enlarged if now we start having hepatic or liver amoebiasis. Then other symptoms we might now have is fever and low back pain. Normally now this might come up when the protozoa goes to the blood. okay, or the port circulation. Then we have lungs, and other organs might also be affected. We can also have lungs having amoebiasis. So as I said earlier, we can have extraluminal, or what we are calling extraintestinal amoebic disease. And these are basically where we have other secondary sites, okay? Apart from the liver, we can have amoebic infection of the skin. And I'm sure maybe you've seen some people with these skin rashes where basically the amoeba, the entamoeba histolytica actually has gone to the skin. Then balanitis, this is the glans penis, and then amoebic lung abscess. See, we can have lung abscess there, then even in the brain. Okay, so how do we diagnose? The main diagnostic method is mostly laboratory diagnosis, and it's normally done through taking a stool sample. Okay, so three consecutive samples can be taken, but the main thing here is just knowing that the stool sample will be taken. What will be seen mostly will be cyst in stool, or if it is a diarrheal stool, if it's a loose stool, then we expect to see even some trophozoites. However, if it has gone to the liver, we can aspirate the liver abscess. If it has penetrated, obviously, the portal circulation, then they can look at serum and they see if there's some sort of antibodies against it. And then pleural fluid, that is if it has gone to the lungs, and then pericardial fluid if it has also obviously affected the heart. Okay, so the standard testing is basically microscopy of the stool for trophozoites and cyst. So management, basically if it's mild form and you're symptomatic, basically no treatment is necessary. However, if it's invasive and we have symptomatic form of the amoebiasis, the treatment mostly of choice is just oral metronidazole, 800 milligrams hourly. Also, others might use oral diloxamide, furoates. In hepatic amoebiasis, basically metronidazole is very, very effective. Okay, so metronidazole is the drug of choice. Okay. So, but others still use tinidazole, is also nice, okay? But as you can see, we can have other drugs, okay? Good, so prevention and control, very important, is that the cyst passers who are usually asymptomatic, usually are the ones who propagate the transmission. So if we get these people and be able to control, we will be able to actually prevent a lot of spread. So advise people to boil drinking water so that the cysts can actually be killed. The cysts are not killed by chlorination. That's why you find that the water that is actually getting chlorinated will not do a lot. Then search for and treat the carriers among food handlers, then campaign for more latrines, because if more use latrines, then there's low chance of actually getting the cysts ingested. Then conducting community campaigns about good hygiene practices such as regular hand washing. Okay, so thank you very much. I hope you've gotten something about amoebiasis. So kindly feel free to subscribe.